Hey folks, my name is John Lee, and welcome back to the channel. Okay, now that we've gotten all of the historical background information out of the way, we can finally talk about the movie itself, Shinmido. Now, as I've already covered all of the background historical information, I won't rehash them here. But if you haven't seen them yet, don't worry about it, I'll provide the link so that you can watch them later on your own. Now, personally, I think Shinmido is a great movie. It deals with politics, it deals with the military, it deals with the Cold War. It also deals with questions such as ethics and morality. It packs a lot of punch, and I think a lot of people would find this movie entertaining. But that being said, Shinmido also has some historical inaccuracies, and we'll list them one by one. Now let's get into the movie's first inaccuracy. Now in the first part of this trilogy that I made, I talked about Unit 124, and this movie does the same thing. It also talks about Unit 124, which of course it doesn't really explain in detail as I did. But in this movie, there are some historical inaccuracies. Now, in this movie, it appears as though Unit 124 was discovered the moment they crossed over into South Korea. As soon as they arrive in South Korea, they're still in the mountains and they're talking amongst themselves as to what they're going to do to attack the Blue House. But even before their speech ends, they're discovered by the South Korean army and they're hunted down and killed immediately. But as I said in the previous video, this did not happen the way the movie portrayed it. The real Unit 124 was able to evade capture for more than a week. And also, they don't get killed in the mountains, they get pretty close to the Blue House. That doesn't appear in the movie at all. Now, granted, I understand why they went with this direction. This movie is supposed to be about Unit 684, not 124. And so, in order to give just enough historical background, they inserted this 5-minute long scene at the start of the movie, but it's not historically accurate. But anyway, due to Unit 124's failed attempt to assassinate President Park Chung-hee and the North Korean government's capture of the USS Pueblo about 2 days later, things are about as chaotic as they could possibly be for South Korea. However, because the United States would not allow South Korea to retaliate against the North Koreans, the South Korean government decides to go with an eye-for-an-eye approach. Instead of militarily retaliating against North Korea, the South Korean government decides to create Unit 684. Because Unit 124 was filled with 31 elite North Korean commandos, Unit 684 would be full of 31 elite South Korean commandos with a similar mission, that they would infiltrate North Korea to assassinate the North Korean leader, Kim Il-sung. The movie's second historical mistake is probably its biggest one. In the movie, Unit 684 is filled with people who are on death row, murderers, rapists, thieves, and gangsters. All of society's dregs. And just as they're about to meet the hangman, they are secretly taken away by the Korean Central Intelligence Agency to form Unit 684. That was not what the real Unit 684 was made of. Unit 684 was actually full of civilians who had volunteered to serve in Unit 684. Now, it's true that there were gangsters in Unit 684, but they weren't all gangsters, and they definitely were not on death row. Unit 684 was recruited among a wide group of people. There were some people who were also members of circus troops. There were also some people who were unemployed. But whoever these people were, all of these people had certain sets of skills that the Korean Central Intelligence Agency was looking for. Some people knew how to fight well. Some people who had worked in the circus knew how to throw knives. Some people knew how to run really fast. These were all people with different skill sets that the KCIA believed would be useful to actually serve in Unit 684. But who exactly came up with the idea for Unit 684? Well, the movie doesn't talk about this that much in detail, but it becomes a very important plot point later on. The man who came up with the idea was a man named Kim Hyung-wook, and he was the director of the Korean Central Intelligence Agency from 1963 to 1969. In the movie, Kim Hyung-wook's name isn't even mentioned at all, but it's really important to understand who he was. Now, this bit of information is not in the movie. Like I said before many times, and I'll say again many times, Korean movies are made for a Korean audience. And again, as usual, the people who made this movie assumed that the audience would know the history. And so, they didn't mention this that much. But since you might not know it, I'll explain this bit in detail just a little bit. Kim Hyung-wook was not a nice man. He was initially a commander in the Korean War, and later, in 1961, he helped Park Chung-hee to lead a coup against the South Korean government, which allowed Park Chung-hee to become the South Korean leader. For the services that he provided, Park Chung-hee made Kim Hyung-wook the director of the Korean Central Intelligence Agency from 1963 to 1969. And while he was the director of the KCIA, he was notorious for his brutality and his corruption. Later on, in the late 1960s, Kim Hyung-wook and Park Chung-hee had a bit of a falling out of sorts, and Kim Hyung-wook decided that he was not going to support Park Chung-hee's bid to become president again for a third term. Due to his refusal to support his third term bid, Park Chung-hee one night invited Kim Hyung-wook to dinner. During this dinner party, Park Chung-hee told Kim Hyung-wook that he was grateful for his long service, but that it might have been time for Kim Hyung-wook to take some rest. When Kim Hyung-wook returned to his office, he found his office had already been cleared, and that was how he got fired. Naturally, Kim Hyung-wook felt a little bit of a grudge when he left the government. Later on, in the 1970s, Kim Hyung-wook would turn out to be quite the thorn in President Park Chung-hee's side. In the 1970s, when the United States Congress was caught in a scandal called Koreagate, Kim Hyung-wook testified in Congress against the South Korean government. He talked about how the South Korean government tried to assassinate the opposition leader, Kim Dae-jung, and how the South Korean government was corrupt and tried to bribe American officials. Kim Hyung-wook also later published his memoirs where he detailed all of the corruptions and the crimes of the Park Chung-hee regime. For his transgressions, Kim Hyung-wook was later killed by the KCIA, and his body was disposed of in the woods somewhere in Paris. To know more about Kim Hyung-wook, there's actually a great movie called The Man Standing Next. It's a movie that details the assassination of President Park Chung-hee, and I believe it's on Netflix and it has English subtitles as well. If you want, you should give that a watch. That movie will detail a little bit more about Kim Hyung-wook. Anyway, let's get back to this movie. So Unit 684 was Kim Hyung-wook's brainchild, and it was completely funded by the KCIA. So in April 1968, 31 of these men were brought to the island of Silmido, which is an uninhabited island about 20 kilometers or about 12 miles from the port city of Incheon. Now, let's talk about these men just a little bit. As I said earlier, the men who were recruited to serve in Unit 684 were not soldiers. They were recruited from all walks of life, and they did not have the kind of training or the discipline needed to become commandos. And so, who trained these men to become the walking weapons that they would later become? Although Unit 684 was created and funded by the KCIA, they were not trained by KCIA agents. The people who did the military training were actually from the Air Force, and this was accurately portrayed in the movie. So when Unit 684 first arrives in Silmido, they don't take things quite seriously and discipline is quite lax. And in the movie, one of the drill instructors decides to show that he's being serious by firing at the ankles of the soldiers on the boat so that they would be forced off the boat to go to swim. However, that's not how exactly it worked out in real life. In real life, when Unit 684 refused to obey orders, the drill instructors actually fired live rounds at them and immediately killed two of them. So, on the very first day, the 31 men became 29. Naturally, the fear of death would later turn out to become a huge motivational force, and a lack of discipline never became a problem after that. From this point on, the first half of the movie becomes a training montage. The men take part in brutal military training exercises. However, the movie only focuses on the physical aspects of their training. It doesn't talk about their mental state. Now, I'm going to talk again very briefly about Unit 124. In the previous video that I talked about them, Unit 124 made some fatal mistakes when they were in South Korea. Due to the inadequate propaganda lessons that were drilled into their heads, they believed that when they arrived in South Korea, they would be greeted by the South Korean public as liberators. The South Korean government was not going to make the same mistake that the North Koreans did. So Unit 684 was trained like North Koreans. They were trained to fight, think, and even speak like North Koreans. In fact, they were even taught North Korean military cadences. If they were to succeed in their mission to assassinate North Korean leader Kim Il-sung, they had to be able to fool everyone in North Korea to think that they were North Korean soldiers. After training for more than a year, in October 1969, Unit 684 was finally ready to go on their mission. However, right at that point, something unexpected happened. Their benefactor, Korean Central Intelligence Agency Director Kim Hyung-wook, was fired, and he was replaced by Lee Hoo-rak. As soon as Lee Hoo-rak became the new KCIA director, their mission was cancelled. This was a devastating blow to Unit 684. They were supposed to train for only a few months before going on their mission to assassinate Kim Il-sung. But now that Kim Hyung-wook had been fired and he had been replaced by Yoo-ra, the very reason for their existence no longer existed. In fact, a year later, in October 1970, while they were still in Chilmido training to go on their mission that was no longer going to happen, the KCIA suspended any funding for them. Now, in the movie, Unit 684's training is brutal. But that being said, in some ways, Unit 684 is well taken care of. In one particular scene, it shows that the soldiers in Unit 684 are fed very well, especially when compared to other soldiers at the time. But later on, after Yoo-ra has taken over as the KCI director and their funding had been cut, their food is no longer nearly as good as it was before. But did their training regimen get any easier? No, it didn't. It was still the same. But they were not treated nearly as well as they used to be. And so naturally, Unit 684 gets really angry. In the meantime, in the late 1960s and early 1970s, inter-Korean relations began to improve. It was no longer about confrontation, but more about negotiation. And so, as far as the authorities were concerned, Unit 684 was an embarrassment that they did not wish to be reminded of. In early 1968, even though Unit 124 failed to assassinate President Park Chung-hee, dozens of civilians and soldiers died because of their attempt, and the South Korean public was angry at North Korea. They wanted blood. But by this point in time, even their anger had subsided. Unit 684 lost any support that they once had for their existence. So although Unit 684 was supposed to be in Chilmido for only a few months, in the end, they spent 3 years and 4 months on that island. And because Unit 684's existence is such an embarrassment, the powers that be decide that it might be time to now retire Unit 684. Now, the movie doesn't exactly name names, so it doesn't explicitly say if it was the president or the KCIA director who decide that they should be done away with. But the order is made nonetheless. Now, the commanding officers who oversee Unit 684 are to have them killed. But that scene only existed in the movie. In real life, while Unit 684 had been effectively mothballed, and they were certainly abused and underfed, there's no evidence to suggest that there was an order that was issued to have Unit 684 killed. From the bit of evidence that we have available, what actually happened was that Unit 684 had finally had enough. After having spent 3 years and 4 months on Chilmido, they were determined that if this was to be their lot in life, they would rather escape. Now, by this point, the men of Unit 684 were not the same people who landed in Chilmido 3 years earlier. They had been trained for 3 years to be killers, to be commandos. And so, using the training that they received, they raided the armory, took out the guns, and they used those weapons to kill their former instructors. Among the 24 instructors who were on that island, only 6 of them managed to survive. Now armed with those weapons, Unit 684 threatened a passing fishing boat and catch a ride. And for the first time after 3 years, they finally stepped foot on the Korean mainland. And once they arrive on the mainland, Unit 684 hijacks a bus. And they have only one destination in mind. The presidential palace, the Blue House. Because they want to get some things off their chest. But Unit 684 was not exactly subtle about their movement. And they left behind a lot of witnesses. Not long after Unit 684 left Chilmido, the Ministry of Defense received a radio message, and the radio message was quite simple. About 20 armed guerrillas had hijacked a bus and were headed towards Seoul. And the word used to describe Unit 684 was 무장공비, which is a Korean word used for armed communist insurgents. We have to remember that Unit 684 was, at the time, a top secret military organization. Aside from the people who had to know, no one else knew about Unit 684. So, as far as the rest of the people were concerned, Unit 684 was a repeat of Unit 124 from 1968. So naturally, the 1,300 airmen who were stationed at the Air Force headquarters were ordered to track down these communist insurgents. In fact, even the media began to call them communist insurgents too. By the time that the bus Unit 684 hijacked arrived in Seoul, Unit 684 was completely surrounded from all sides. There was a short firefight, but naturally, over time, Unit 684 ran out of ammunition. And so, instead of surrendering, everyone who was still alive in the bus detonated their grenades, and they all chose to commit mass suicide. Unisex 84 didn't even get to say goodbye to their families. As far as the world was concerned, Unisex 84 was yet another North Korean attempt to infiltrate South Korea with commandos to assassinate the South Korean president. Miraculously, four members of Unisex 84 survived the grenade blast from the bus. But they didn't survive for long. The four surviving members were later tried in a military tribunal, and they were all executed. The truth behind Unisex 84 did not get revealed to the public until 1998. But why did they get revealed at all? That's because in 1998, something unexpected had happened. Remember that opposition figure that Park Chung-hee tried to assassinate? Kim Dae-jung? Well, in 1998, he finally became the South Korean president. Now, as I said, this movie has its fair share of historical inaccuracies, and it does skip over some historical information that the movie assumes that the audience is already familiar with. But even if you're not aware of any of this historical information, I still highly recommend this movie because, at the end of the day, this movie is still entertaining. It's a great movie, and I recommend it to anyone. Alright, that about wraps it up. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to click on the like and the subscribe button as well as the notification bell. And if you have a comment, leave them down below. My name is John Lee, and I'll see you all next time. Bye.